This morning I've titled my message, Leaven and Leprosy. And the reason that I titled it that way, the Lord I was actually praying, and as I was praying, I was thinking about the lepers. The word unclean came into my heart, and I felt like the Lord wanted me to, I started there, and this is kind of where I've ended up. But you know, two of these two words, leaven and leprosy, are a big part of, I believe, the Old Testament. And they tell us a story, amen? Whenever you look at the concept of leaven, what you begin to realize is that leaven is something that takes place internally. And both of these, both leaven and leprosy, both represent sinfulness. They represent sin in various aspects of the way that it is. As a matter of fact, I'm going to go ahead and, right there, let's see. Leaven. Well, I messed it up. There we go. Come on. There we go. Leaven. See, leaven is, to a baker, it's a good thing, right? They put it in there to cause the bread to rise. You can see the unleavened bread to the bottom right there. It's flat and it doesn't have, leaven is yeast. It doesn't have yeast in it, right? But the other one is, it's risen. And so for a baker, it's a good thing. But see, leaven has the idea like internal sin in the sense that whenever it gets in there, it begins to spread. You can't stop it. Once there's a little bit in it, it can't stop it. But from the biggest perspective, I want you to understand this morning that leaven represents that aspect of sin that's internal. It represents that aspect of sin that's inside of man. And as a matter of fact, according to Genesis chapter 1 verse 26, and you don't have to turn, I'll just read it to you. The Word of God says, "And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." If you would have been here last week, I preached on Cornelius. You remember that? And I preached on Peter and how he had a vision on the roof of Simon the Tanner. This doesn't have anything to do with my message this morning, but I thought it was interesting and it stuck out as I read that scripture, because in the sheet that was lowered down was all manner of unclean animals. Remember that? Four-footed beasts, beasts of the earth, creeping things. I also told you how in Romans chapter 1, it explains that mankind no longer regarded God and worshipped Him the way that He was supposed to, but instead made images with their hands of beasts and four-footed animals and creeping things. And the truth is that when I read this morning, I realized, you know, God desired for man to have dominion over this earth, but that because of the fall of man and because of the infiltration of sin, that through idolatry, these very things that man was supposed to have dominion over have now gained dominion over him. And in a spiritual sense, demon spirits have caused mankind to build idols in order to exert worship towards them instead of them worshiping the God that set them free or created them, amen, and desires to set them free. And even if you're not worshiping a statue, although there are a lot of people that do that, the truth of the matter is that the same world system wants to cause you to worship something else or to have something else on the forefront of your heart and in your mind rather than God. And so, but back to leaven. Leaven infiltrates, it's internal, it gets in, it's that aspect of sin that's on the inside of man, and really it represents the fall of man. Man was originally created in the image and likeness of God. And now whenever man goes the way of the serpent, now a change takes place. An internal change takes place. And the Word of God says in Genesis chapter 5 verse 3, I share these scriptures a lot, but it says, "And Adam lived 130 years, and he begat a son in his own likeness after his image, and he called his name Seth." You see the change that's taken place. Originally man's created in the image and likeness of God. But then man takes sin into himself. And now coming forth from Adam, all men are affected with this problem called sin. And sin is representative, once again, in the Old Testament of leaven. As a matter of fact, in one other interesting thing in the New Testament, and I've talked about this many times, but sometimes we have new people that come in. In Romans chapter 6, the word sin is used 19 times from the end of Romans 5 through all of Romans 6. The word sin is used 19 times. And in 18 of those times, this word in the Greek is there in front of it, the, which is a definite article. And what does that mean? It means that the word is a noun. Now, why is that important? Because it means it's not focused on verbs of sin. I'm trying to make a point. Many times whenever we're in the church, we focus on the verbs of people's sin. We look at their lives. We look at the things that they still do that we don't do. And we judge them accordingly. And we think, well, you know what? I don't have the problem that they have, so therefore I'm more righteous than what they are. No, the issue of what this noun sin is trying to speak of is a sinful nature. The very thing that we receive from our father Adam is representative of the internal nature, kind of like the leaven is, that gets into the dough and it begins to spread. And so that's inside of man because of his first birth in Adam. The good news is that Jesus, amen, was the bread from heaven. Hallelujah. And so in Exodus 12, that's what the feast was about. It was a feast of unleavened bread. And it started off with the Passover. We talk about that feast a lot in the Bible study because it's very representative of the cross of Jesus Christ. The feast started off with the Passover, where that lamb was taken and its throat was cut and its blood was collected. And the doorpost of their house was painted with the blood. And God said that on that night, I'm going to send the death angel through. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. In other words, judgment won't fall on the house where the blood has been applied to the doorpost. That was the first night of the feast, the Passover. And then from then on, for 7 days and 7 nights, they were to eat bread that didn't have leaven in it. They weren't supposed to have yeast in their bread. And not only that, they weren't supposed to have it in their home. And every year that they were supposed to observe this festival or this feast. And it was a reminder. God said, you're going to do this every year as a reminder. It's almost like it was a preaching sermon that took place every year for thousands of years to remind Israel that they were supposed to be a separated people, that they weren't supposed to have leaven in their home, and that leaven represented sin, and that it was supposed to be removed far from them. And not only that, every year they were supposed to offer up this animal as a sacrifice. And I've told you before already how God said that if you do this every year, at some point your children are going to start to ask questions. Why do we do this? And you're going to be able to tell them because God delivered you out from under the bondage of Egypt, which is the world. But you know, the first time that I saw this particular scripture. If you have your Bible, you might want to turn with me to Exodus 12. And I just wanted to point out this one scripture from this passage. It says in verse 17, "You shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for in this selfsame day I have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, you observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever." I just thought it was interesting. I never noticed it before where he said, "I brought your armies out of Egypt on this day." You know, armies represent battle. Armies represent strength. They represent our ability to fight. Egypt not only represents the world, but it also represents a place of bondage. The good news is that for the children of God, God's saying, "I brought your armies, I brought your fighting power out from under bondage, out from under the world system." And in a similar fashion, the way that God sent us Jesus, the Passover lamb, amen, he's also delivered us and given us the ability to walk and to fight in the midst of this world that we live in. He's brought us out from under bondage, and he's come to give us victory, amen, in the name of Jesus. The good news is that Jesus is our unleavened bread. Word of God says in John chapter 6, we don't even have to turn there, but in John chapter 6, he says, "I am the manna from heaven." And he says, "And I am the bread of life." And he said, "And the life that I give is my flesh." He was talking about offering himself on the cross and the fact that he was. You see, you got to understand something, that mankind born of Adam is born with leaven in him. It's an internal problem. It's a noun called sin. And it's from that source or that root that's in him that all these other actions begin to flow. Listen, the Old Testament, this is one of the main things I wanted to get across to you this morning, so I don't want to miss it. The Old Testament pointed to sin. You understand? It pointed to it. It explained it. It defined it. It showed it to you what it was, how ugly it was. But it could not do a work on that internal aspect of the problem of sin. It left mankind in a place of separation. He went on to say that if you don't observe this feast every year for these 7 days, which is the number of completion and fulfillment, if you don't do it, then your soul is going to be cut off from the camp. In other words, a person who would not observe it and be mindful of the fact that sin was a problem in the life of the child of God and would not continue to observe it, he would be separated from the presence of God. He would be separated from the camp of God, which describes the whole camp of Israel, which is the people of God. I want you to understand that. Sin causes separation. As a matter of fact, I'm not going to turn there either, but, well, look, if you got your Bible, let's turn to Genesis chapter 3, verse 24. We're talking about separation. It says, whenever Adam and Eve fell, because of the internal problem now that was in them of sin, the Bible says God drove out the man and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. Inside the garden was the presence of God where God dwelled with man, but now that sin has come into the picture, man is driven outside the presence of God and he cannot just easily enter back in. There's a whole message there to preach and I know that I'll preach it soon, but the main point that I want you to understand is that sin, leaven, it enters in, it's internal, it's an internal problem, it begins to spread out. It started with Adam and it spread through the whole human race, and mankind born of Adam is born in a place of separation. He's outside the camp, he can't get back in. The Old Testament represented it, it showed it, it defined it, but it could not do anything for the internal aspect of sin that mankind was stricken with. The next thing that I wanted to talk to you about was leprosy. I know that's a rough looking picture right there, but you know, nowadays we understand a little bit more. I actually missed that trip, I believe, to the... Did you go to the leper colony in school? We didn't go the Irish semester. Sean, you got to go? Yeah, there was a leper colony in Louisiana, but you know, the truth is that back in these days, they didn't really know what leprosy was caused from. We understand now that it's actually a bacteria. It's caused from a bacteria, so it's contagious. And one of the things that was interesting to me, at least what I read this morning, because I guess I didn't really realize it because I missed the field trip, but that it said that leprosy was spread through respiratory droplets, like the flu. But yet it's a skin ailment. And so whenever somebody would sneeze or cough, like the flu, even probably like the bubonic plague, I guess, I haven't really Googled that in a while, but the sickness would come on the inside, but yet it would manifest. See, I didn't even think about that till just now when I said it. The sickness was actually something that was internal, but it began to be manifest externally, and it was contagious. You see what I'm saying? And see, in the book of Leviticus, and it began to really, it caused dysmorphic features. It began to cause people's fingers, they would lose their fingers, changes taking place to their face, and it would eat away at the very life of what the person was. In the book of Leviticus chapter 13, the entire chapter, 59 verses, is spent specifically on the concept of leprosy. And the whole purpose of it is to prevent the spread of this contagious plague. As a matter of fact, the word plague is used 35 times in there. 23 times the words clean or unclean are used, and 13 times the word seven or seventh is used. Once again, completion, amen, and God bringing to fulfillment something, whether it be a healing, whether it be wrath, or whatever the case. All the 59 verses devoted to, and if you tried to read it, you would probably have a hard time reading it. I read it. I've read it multiple times. I read it again yesterday. I have to be honest with you. It's not one of the most exciting chapters, but in the midst of it all, if you find the particular verse where everything hinges on, if you turn to Leviticus 13 verse 44, I want to tell you basically the nuts and bolts of what the problem of leprosy did. Because it was contagious, God wanted to make sure that it didn't spread in the midst of the camp. Amen? And so basically what would happen is that if there was a lesion anywhere on the body that looked like it could be leprous, he would have to present himself to the priest. And the priest would look at the lesion and say, I'm just not sure. It might be leprosy. We have to isolate you for 7 days. In 7 days, we isolate you. You're going to go outside of the camp. You come back in. We reinspect. Then we'll determine whether or not this is leprosy or not. If it was found to be leprosy, now we have a problem because we got a verdict that we got to speak over your life, and it's forever going to change your life. You'll never be the same if you come back and you got leprosy. It says right here in verse 44, he is a leprous man. He is unclean. The priest shall pronounce him utterly unclean. His plague is in his head. And the leper in whom the plague is, his clothes shall be rent, and his head bare, and he shall put a covering upon his upper lip, and he shall cry, unclean, unclean. All the days wherein the plague shall be in him, he shall be defiled. He is unclean, and he shall dwell alone without the camp, shall his habitation be. What I wanted you to understand is this, is that in this passage of scripture, what's taking place is that this person has now been pronounced to have leprosy. So whereas the leaven represented specifically the internal nature of sin, and leprosy also has an internal aspect to it, it becomes manifest on the outside. Amen. What I need you to understand is that until the internal aspect of sin is dealt with, and I want to get to that, then the truth of the matter is that we will never be able to see a change taking place externally in the midst of our lives. But what happens is that his life is forever changed. He's been given a diagnosis, if you will, and it's also a verdict. You're unclean. And so these people had to walk around like this, and they would cover themselves because of shame, because of the disaster, the destruction that was taking place in their body. And the truth of the matter is that each and every one of us know that if we allow certain types of sin to have their way in the midst of our lives, we see that it will cause external destruction in our lives. We see it in people's lives left and right. It takes place. God is a God of reconciliation. He is a God of restoration. But don't think for one minute that the internal aspect of sin, if it's left unchecked for too long, won't begin to cause changes externally in the midst of your life. Sometimes it's physical. Sometimes it's financial. Sometimes it's relational. The truth of the matter is that sin unchecked, sin undealt with, will begin to cause disastrous effects. Amen. In the midst of our lives. Amen. Unclean is what he would have to scream. It was really not much hope for a leper in the Old Testament. Once again, that's one of the things that I'm trying to get across to you this morning, is the difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament. The difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. In the New Covenant, Jesus has come to make something happen on the inside, amen? And that's really the emphasis of my message, and we're about to get there in a second. Jesus wants to change things on the inside of man. He wants to bring hope. He's the bread from heaven. He's the living bread, amen? And he wants to make change, hallelujah. You know, once again, there wasn't much hope for a leper in the Old Testament. There's really only, that I know of, two recorded healings of leprosy in the Old Testament. The first one was a woman named Miriam. Y'all know who Miriam is? Does anybody know who Miriam is? For the longest time, I didn't know who Miriam was. I was a Christian for 12 years and didn't know who Miriam was. I didn't even know who Aaron was. Oh, I didn't know that Miriam and Aaron were Moses' brother and sister. I didn't know that. Okay, now I know it, so I'm trying to tell you. I want you to make sure you know. Miriam and Aaron were Moses' brother and sister. And in the book of Numbers, there's a story that takes place. I'm just kind of talking a little bit about leprosy right now, and the fact that there was a very hopeless situation, and the fact that it represented separation. And that Miriam and Aaron began to murmur and complain one day because it seems as though Moses ended up marrying an Ethiopian woman. We're not going to get into that too much, but they didn't approve of Moses marrying this Ethiopian woman. And Miriam all of a sudden begins to say, "Who says that Moses is the only one that God talks to? Aren't we all prophets? Doesn't he speak to all of us?" And the word of God says that the Lord heard her murmuring. And he called them all outside the camp so that he could talk to them. And whenever God began to talk to him, he said, "Listen to me. Whenever there's another prophet in the camp, you'll know it because I, God, will speak to him in a dream, because that's how I choose to do it. This is how I do it, but not so with Moses. I will speak to him as a man speaks to his friend. I will talk to him the way that I desire to talk to him." And because of Miriam's attitude and what was really internally on the inside of her heart, all of a sudden she became white like a leper. Her skin began to change before her very eyes. Because, see, God considered her unclean. See, many times in our life, we look at all the external sins that are going on, and that's how we judge people. Oh, boy, still got a problem with drugs. Oh, girl, still does this over there. And all these little things that we can see. But we don't realize that whenever God gets rid of all those external external things. Come on, somebody. When he starts getting rid of the drug problem, when he starts getting rid of the sex problem, he wants to start dealing with the interior of man. He wants to start dealing with the motives of a man's heart. He wants to deal with jealousy. He wants to deal with envy. He wants to deal with anger and bitterness. He wants to start letting you in. He wants to get in on the inside and start dealing with things. And here's Miriam. She's full of envy. She's full of jealousy. And the next thing you know, she's full of leprosy. And all of a sudden, Aaron realizes we got a problem. Because, see, he's the priest. And it's his job to pronounce that she's leprous. And she's got to be sent outside of the camp. But Aaron goes to Moses and he says, Moses, we were wrong in what we did. You got to go to the Lord. You got to go to the Lord and you got to intercede, essentially, on her behalf. The word of God said that Moses said, oh, Lord, I beseech you, take this away from her now, please. The word of God says that she was made whole. Hallelujah. All of a sudden she was made whole, but the Lord told Moses, nevertheless, let her stay outside the camp for 7 days. See, there was still a time of separation. But the good news is this, is that she was able to come back. Hallelujah. Amen. The good news is that God made her whole and she was able to come back. And I need you to understand that when we talk about the aspect of leaven, and we talk about the aspect of leprosy, and the fact that they both caused the people of Israel, God's people, to be separated, at the same time, just as Jesus was unleavened bread from heaven, amen, the sinless one that came and offered his life in our place, also Moses' intercession for Miriam, Jesus interceded for you and I, amen? Amen. Jesus interceded for you and I when he went to the cross and paid the penalty of our sin, and he caused something called reconciliation to take place. See, if sin causes separation, then the forgiveness of Jesus causes peace to be able to take place between God and man. Amen? And that was what I wanted to talk to you about just for a second out of Romans chapter 5. We're going to look at this scripture twice this morning. But the first thing I wanted to tell you about was this, is that being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand. See, Miriam had leprosy. The leper had leprosy. And the leprosy was a sign of sin. And sin internally in man separates him from the presence of God. And therefore that means that he's not at peace with God. He's at war with God. You understand that? And so he finds himself on the outside. But Moses interceded. Jesus interceded. Amen. And now because of the intercession of Jesus, we've been made to be at peace with God. And now we have access into the grace of God in which we stand. We've been granted access back into his presence. We've been granted access back to his grace. Now, I put the definition of grace on here. I wanted you to see that. And of course, here I did it again. Just bear with me. The word grace here is this in the Greek dictionary, that it's a divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in the life. I've copy and pasted that straight out of my Bible app, my Strong's Bible app. I quote this definition quite often to people that come to the church because I want you to understand that grace is more than just God's unmerited favor. In other words, yes, you can't earn God's grace. God, Jesus had to purchase grace for you. Amen. But I need you to understand that it's bigger than that, that it's more than that. That grace literally is a, just as yeast or leaven gets on the inside of man and spreads inside of man and causes various actions to take place, sin in, sin out. You understand what I'm saying? Grace does the same thing in the opposite fashion. Whenever Jesus made you right with God, the Holy Spirit came to live on the inside of you. And as God, the Holy Spirit dispenses grace in your life based upon your faith in Jesus and the cross, what he did for you, now you're clothed in righteousness. Because you're righteous, you have access to the grace of God, and now the grace of God on the inside of you is like a reverse leaven, if you will, and it's having its action and it's doing its work on the internal aspect of man, so much so that it begins to influence his outward actions. You see what it says right there? A divine influence upon the heart. What does divine mean? It means God. It's not a human influence. It's a divine or a godly influence upon the heart, which is the interior of man, the inside of man. And it influences man's heart so much so that it's reflected in his outward life. Amen? That's a good word. See, what I want you to know, and really what I plan on preaching more than anything, once again, has to do with the difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. That the Old Covenant pointed out that you have a problem called sin, but it left man on the outside looking in. It could not reach in, and it could not do on the interior what man needed him to do. What I need you to understand this morning is that you can't try to live for God according to an old system of rules and regulations. You cannot try to live for God according to an old system of man's performance. Man cannot perform enough to make himself right in the eyes of God. You can't read enough Bible. Hear me, church. You can't go to church enough. I want you to come to church. You can't go to church enough. You can't read the Bible enough. You can't pray enough. You can't fast enough. You can't do anything. There's no performance that man can do in order to be pleasing in the eyes of God. The new covenant is not built upon man's performance. The new covenant is built upon the performance of Jesus, the bread from heaven, this unleavened bread, the sinless one, the Passover lamb, the one who was righteous, amen, the one who never failed. It's good news that your dependence, your hope, the object of your faith is in the one who never failed. Because if it wasn't the case, brothers and sisters, we're all in a bind and we all got some trouble ahead. Amen? Because even with the grace, we still find ourselves in the midst of the battle. But hallelujah, if we'll just hold on to Jesus, keep your faith in the finished work of the Lamb of God, and trust that grace, a divine influence in the heart, and its reflection in the life, that is going to change you on the inside, and that you're going to be able to start seeing things manifest on the outside. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And so here was Miriam. She was outside the camp. She was in separation. She had leprosy, but Moses interceded. Her leprosy was healed, and she was allowed to have access back because of the intervention of Jesus. You and I have been allowed back into the camp, have been allowed back, amen, to the grace of God. There was another healing of leprosy in the Old Testament. His name was Naaman. He wasn't an Israelite. He was a foreigner. He was a Syrian officer. We preached about him some time back, actually. So in the Miriam story, Moses interceded for her. In the Naaman story, see, Naaman had everything going for him. He was a mighty officer. God, the Bible says God gave him victory. There was times that Syria had victory over Israel. Because, you know, God's people many times were disobedient to him. And, you know, in one of these skirmishes, a little girl, an Israelite girl, was caught up. And she just so happened to end up being the handmaiden for Naaman's wife. And, you know, you would think that in the midst of a bondage situation like that, kind of like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, taken from their home in Jerusalem and brought to Babylon and imprisoned under the Babylonian government, that they would just be dejected and depressed. I mean, it makes sense, right? Sometimes we're not even in jail and we're dejected and depressed. Come on, somebody. You know, but nevertheless, not Daniel, not Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. No, they took a stand. They took a stand. They lived for God. And I was thinking about this little girl. And I just see this little girl just full of life and joy. And one day she says to her, to the mistress, she says, "Oh, I wish that my master would be able to find the prophet of Israel. Oh, I wish that he'd be able to see the prophet of Israel because he would heal him of his leprosy." See, I mean, she brought a testimony. And Naaman was without hope. He was separated outside of the camp of God because he was born a Syrian. There was no hope for him. He didn't have a relationship with God. He didn't know the true God. He worshiped a false God. But nevertheless, God arranged and preordained a circumstance. See, God wants you to be a witness for his kingdom. He wants to let the grace of God get in and work on the inside to where it becomes reflected outwardly. And you, like this little girl, amen, start to speak forth the truth of God in other people's lives. People walk around with leprosy without any hope, yet you got hope. Oh, I wish that you get a hold of the Jesus that the Father sent to take care of your leprous condition. And that's what she said. I wish that my master would be able to see the prophet of God because he'd heal him of his leprosy. She had no doubt in the God that she served. She knew that Elisha was a mighty prophet of God. The miracles followed him everywhere that he went. He had a double portion of Elijah's miracles. Well, you know what? With time, it happened. Naaman ends up going, and he finds his way going over to meet the prophet. But the prophet doesn't even come out and talk to him. The prophet sends a messenger. Tell him to go to the Jordan River and to dip seven times. There's seven again.
Yeah.
Oh, look, Naaman is so frustrated. Yeah. You mean to tell me I ride all the way over here, an officer of the Syrian army? I come over here to see this prophet, and he basically said something like, I just figured he'd come over here and he'd wave his hand over me, and the next thing you know, the leprosy would be gone. Mm-hmm. Aren't the rivers of Syria much more clean than this Jordan River? He doesn't want, you see, he thinks that he is above Israel. He thinks he's above the ways of God. And I have to tell you that in Miriam's heart and in Naaman's heart, we see these internal characteristics of sin that many times we can't see because all the drugs and the fornication and all that other stuff is on the outside of our lives. And there's other things on the inside that God's wanting to deal with. And I'm telling you right now, I got a problem with people that focus on somebody that has a drug problem, but yet this person has a jealousy problem, a bitter problem, an envy problem, and they won't let God deal with their own problem, and they want to focus on everybody else's. Come on, man. We got to let the Lord deal with the inside stuff.
Amen. Amen.
And here's Naaman, and he's full of it. He's full of pride, and Miriam's full of envy and jealousy. And finally, what ends up happening is that his people, the servants that are with him, they plead with him. Come on. What do you have to lose? I mean, think about it now. Jesus, the Son of God, is going to be baptized in these waters in about 1,000 years or 600 years. The water's too good for you, Naaman. And he goes, the Bible says that he goes and he does. He allows himself to be dipped seven times. And on the seventh time, when he comes out of the water, the Bible says that his skin was like the skin of a baby. God, see, he felt like he was too elevated to do it God's way. And I see in these symptoms of both Miriam and I see in the symptom of Naaman ways of the enemy of our soul. He didn't like the ways of God. He was full of pride. He said he was going to exalt himself. He was envious and jealous of God. And I don't know about you, but I pray that the Lord would deal with that. Amen. I don't want envy and jealousy in me. I don't want pride in me. I want to be able to go the way of God, and I want to appreciate God's ways. Amen. And the way that he desires things to be done. Lord, help us to have a desire to do things your way. What I really wanted to preach, that was my introduction, is Luke chapter 5. Amen? In Luke chapter 5, there is five movements of action that take place in Luke chapter 5. And the five movements of action, I'm not going to be able to preach all of them. I'm going to preach some of them tonight. First, there, and once again, I want to be reminded, because the title of my message, I don't think, reflects really what I'm trying to communicate as much. The old covenant was limited in that it did not deal with the internal aspect. And many times, we want to hold on to old ways of doing and old ways of thinking. The new covenant was different in that Jesus was the new covenant, and what he came to bring changed everything on the inside. The old covenant was built on works and man's performance. The new covenant is built on grace and Jesus' performance. Amen. And in Luke chapter 5, I believe that we see five different movements of action that all in some way reflect this truth. Mankind is always looking to see something outward take place that proves to him that something's going on. But the new covenant does something on the inside that ultimately reflects outwardly. Amen? The first movement of action is that Peter and some of the other disciples are fishing at night. They've been fishing all night long, and they haven't caught anything. They have empty nets. You know, the truth is, again, once again, we're talking about something being filled up on the inside. These boys have been working all night long and their nets are empty. There's nothing left on the inside. All right? Number two, there's a leper. He's a leper and he's desperate. And he has no hope, yet he sees Jesus. And Jesus touches him and makes him whole. Amen. Number three, there's a paralytic. There's a paralytic and he has no way to get to Jesus. The crowd has approached the house so much so that there's no way to get in to see him. But yet, in desperation, his friends desire for him to be able to see Jesus so bad, the Bible says that they start pulling away the tiling, which literally you're talking about burnt clay tiles. They pull away the tile. Could you imagine? Jesus is in here preaching. I didn't plan on talking about this much, but it's interesting. Jesus is in here preaching and teaching, and all of a sudden, these people start removing the tile of the roof, and next thing you know, the sun starts shining through into the living room, and they start lowering down a paralytic that's on a mat, amen, and the Lord touches him. He has no hope. He can't walk right for God. You understand that? The Bible says that Jesus touches him, and immediately he got up.
Amen.
That's number three. Number four, there was a man called Levi. His name was Matthew. That's how we know him. He was a tax collector. You got to understand that tax collectors were considered by the Israelite people as the lowest of the low. They were actually financially elevated. They had to pay a price to the Roman government in order to be able to have that position. And so what they would do is that they would collect the taxes from the people and that they would pay Caesar his portion, and whatever was left over they were able to keep for themselves. It was a very lucrative business because they would extort the people in charge of more and they would take a little bit off the top of each person. They would oftentimes have many people that worked for them. As a matter of fact, I'll probably mention it tonight, Zacchaeus was considered a chief tax collector, so he had multiple tax collectors under him. But whenever the Jewish people saw a tax collector, what they saw outwardly was something dirty. Something dirty, something that couldn't be clean. They could not see, they didn't understand, amen, that there was something that God wanted to do once again on the inside. So it's almost impossible. You got to understand that at the time Jesus shows up, they don't understand anything about the new covenant. That's what he's doing. He's preaching. And that's what this whole chapter 5 is about. It's about man seeing things externally and not realizing that Jesus has come to do things internally, to change things and to give hope on the inside. Lastly, he actually finalizes chapter 5 by teaching that. He talks about new wine and old wineskins and that the old wineskin can't handle the new wine. The new wine is the teaching and the new covenant of Jesus. The old wineskin is the Old Testament and the old covenant, and the two of them cannot work together and the one cannot hold the other. And it's just like sewing a new patch onto an old garment. If you do that, then when the new patch shrinks, it tears the old garment. The two of them cannot be operated together. You cannot be a New Testament Christian and have Jesus on the inside of your heart, wanting to move and operate on the inside of your life, and still try to function according to an old covenant standard by doing works of religion and trying to perform outwardly in order to gain righteousness whenever Jesus is true righteousness. Amen? All right. Luke chapter 5 verse 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, which is another name for the Sea of Galilee, and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. So we see a picture where Jesus is basically using the ship and the ocean and the waves and the wind as an amphitheater. He's a natural amphitheater. He's getting out there and the living eternal word has become flesh. He's standing in this boat and he begins to teach the people. And as he teaches the people, after a period of time, in verse 4 it says, "Now when he had left speaking, he said to Simon, 'Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught.'" That's another word for a catch. But look at Simon's answer. "Simon answered and said unto him, 'Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net.'" Now, it goes on to say, "And when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net broke. And they beckoned unto the partners which were in the other ship that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships so that they began to sink." Now, one of the things that ended up pointed out to me was the fact that he said that we've toiled all the night long. And I looked up that word toiled in the original language, and it means to be worn out, to be weary, to be faint, to weary oneself with labor. And this is a perfect picture. Once again, I got to tell you that the overall context of Luke chapter 5 is a difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And this is a perfect picture of the Old Covenant. Let me tell you why. Because in the Old Covenant, mankind was trying to weary himself with labor. Through performance and through ritual and through religion, he was attempting time and time again with the works of his own hands in order to accomplish the righteousness that God desired for him. But what it left was an empty harvest. You understand? And many Christians walk around in the church today and they suffer from the same problem. They toil and they work. And they weary themselves. I'm telling you, you got people that are in nursery and people that work in some of these churches. I've seen it with my own eyes. They've been in nursery. They've been in children's church. And I thank God for the workers. That's why we split it up. Amen. We need it to do it, but it's for a bigger purpose. You're not pleasing God because you work in the nursery. You please God because you put your faith in Jesus, the righteous one, the beloved one, amen? And now whenever you keep your faith there, God gives you grace to do what you know that he wants you to do. What is that? To be fishers of men, to make disciples of men. And so here's Peter, and they're toiling, and they're working themselves with labor, and they're growing weary. Come on, some of you know what I'm talking about. You've seen people that have been in ministry, and they're weary from labor because all of their strength is being poured into trying to work to please God. And you can't work to please God, because the only work that pleases God is Jesus. That's why when Jesus was baptized and he came up out of the water, the voice spoke from heaven and said, "This is my son. This is my beloved son. In him I am well pleased." Amen. God the Father is well pleased with the Son. And if you and I stay in him, he'll be well pleased with us. Amen. The situation though is this, is that they toiled and they labored, but there's no fish. We've already done this, Lord. We've been here all night. We've toiled and we've labored and we've worked and the nets are empty. Nevertheless, at your word, we will do what it is that you ask us to do. See, sometimes when you find yourself in New Covenant Christianity and the preacher, and you're struggling with some things. In other words, your net is empty. You've been praying to the Lord. You've been asking God to show up. You've been asking him to fill up your net. You're asking for a harvest, a blessing. Amen. You understand what I'm saying? You need him to intervene. If he doesn't intervene in the midst of your circumstances, then you're going to have a problem on your hands. You understand what I'm saying? And yet here you are, and you're toiling and you're growing weary as you wait on the promise. And you haven't seen anything. And many times when you don't see anything for a period of time, you become frustrated. You start to lose hope. You start to question whether or not it's really going to work. That's probably what Peter felt a little bit like. I mean, after all, he is a fisherman. He knows it's not like it's his first rodeo. He's done this before. This is what he's done all of his life. And his nets are empty. He knows good and well that the fish aren't biting. Now's not the time, Lord, to throw the net back out there. Nevertheless, at your word, I will do as you ask. And that's what the Lord's asking us to do. He's asking us something that's real simple. And what he's asking of us is that we would believe. That we would believe and trust that his word can do what it says it can do. His word says that Jesus, the bread from heaven, the one whose performance was always right, died in our place. And our faith in that gives us access to grace. I know I'm reminding you. I know I'm repeating. It's really worth repeating, and it's really worth getting on the inside of our hearts that our faith in him and what he accomplished gives us access to grace. Grace on the inside of man is filling up the nets. Grace on the inside of man is the power, is the toil, is the work. Jesus said, "Come unto me, you who are weary and heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You will find rest for your weary souls." Jesus is wanting you and I to know that he's the worker in this relationship. He wants you and I to know that he's the one that's going to get accomplished what we need accomplished in our life. He wants you and I to know that he's the one and the only one that can fill up the net. What ends up happening in this story is that whenever Peter sees the nets full, he ends up falling on his knees in front of Jesus, and he says, "Oh Lord, I'm a sinful man. But you know, the good news is that the first time I read that, I was thinking, well, Jesus knows that. Jesus knows what kind of man or a man that you are. He knows what kind of man or a man that I am. I would imagine in Jesus' heart and in his mind, what he's thinking and saying good about that, what he would have said was, that's the whole point that I came. As a matter of fact, in the end of the chapter, he talks about that. He said that the well don't need a physician. I've come for the sick. The righteous don't need me. I've come for those that are sinners. Amen. And really and truly, he was talking to the Pharisees who thought they were righteous. And the reality of it is that they needed him more than anybody else needed him. But they were blinded by their religion and they couldn't even see it. So here's Peter. He falls to his knees. He says, oh, I'm a sinful man. But Jesus, he ends up touching him. Amen. And he tells him. He goes on to say this. Verse 10. And so also was James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, fear not. From henceforth, you will catch men. Amen. See, it was all planned by God. It was all planned by God for the nets to be empty. It was all planned by God for them to toil all night long and to make themselves weary. And through their toiling and for them to come up empty-handed so that multiple things could happen. Number one, for them, so that they would realize that the efforts of their own work wasn't going to accomplish it. But yet, when Jesus shows up on the scene, he gives them a great harvest. But it was even a bigger picture because he wanted to teach them that you're not just about being a fisherman and being preoccupied with feeding yourself, but instead you're to be now preoccupied with the work of the Father, because the kingdom of God is here now. Amen. The new covenant is here. And in this new covenant, we become fishers of men. But it also serves as a story for you and I to be reminded that New Covenant Christianity is not about our performance, amen?
Amen.
It's about trusting in the performance of Jesus,
yes,
allowing the grace to flow in us, which will now energize or strengthen us. That's what the word talks about when it talks about work. Energy is where we get our word energy from. It's the energy or the power of the Holy Spirit working through us to give us the grace and strength that we need to accomplish what God wants for our life. Listen, I keep reminding myself, and I know I keep saying it, but I can't get it out of my head. God has made it more real today to me than ever before in my walk that this life is so temporary.
Yeah.
This life is so temporary. Now listen to me. I realize that whenever we engage this physical world, that it seems so real. And we feel the pain. And we feel the heartache. And there's things that we want. But the reality of it is that it's temporary. That's one thing that we should all have in common. That we should believe that when we breathe our last breath here, we take our first breath there. Amen. That we finally entered into what our whole purpose was.
Amen.
That's what makes you and I different than the world. What makes you and I different from the world is that the Holy Spirit lives in us and He separated us out from them. And while they're trying to find fulfillment and happiness on this fallen earth, you and I understand that yes, there's going to be times of happiness. Yes, there will be times of joy, but there will also be times of sadness. And nevertheless, though, this isn't the end of the story. The end of the story lays on the other side. It lays on the other side of the horizon. Hallelujah. God's not done with us yet. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. He's called us to be fishers of men.
Yes.
In the new covenant, there's new hope. Amen. It's not just about Israel anymore. In the old covenant, they thought it was just all about them. In a similar fashion, many new covenant Christians walk around thinking it's all about them. I keep getting this story in my mind that somebody told me, that one of my buddies was telling somebody at work. He said, man, I was talking to this old boy and I talked to him about handing out tracts. You know, little pamphlets that talk about you're a sinner, but Jesus died for your sin. That's an easy way to say it. And my friend likes to pass them out. And he was telling, hey man, you ever passed out tracts before? He's like, what are you talking about? I don't want to do that. He said, oh, you don't feel like you need to let people know that Jesus is real? And he said, you know, my friend said, man, I got to do it. I'm not real good with words, but I feel like I got to tell somebody something. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
He said, sometimes I just leave them on people's cars, but sometimes every now and then the Lord will. He said, man, he said, I'm good, dude. And I'm a Christian. I'm going to heaven. If they go to hell, that's on them. And you know, when I thought of that, I'm like, has really the kingdom of God truly entered into your heart? I mean, is that really how you feel? I mean, I'm not saying everybody wants to go pass out tracts. That's not what I'm trying to get at. I'm not trying to make you feel weird and, you know, go by, you know, whatever. That's between you and Jesus. But what I'm trying to say is that you can't just hold on to the kingdom of God. See, the Old Testament Israelite, he thought it was all about him. Amen. The New Testament Christian's not supposed to think that way. Jesus is telling Peter and them, he said, you're to be fishers of men. I'm going to make you fishers of men. And listen, a true disciple is one who learns of Jesus. And you and I are all supposed to be true disciples learning of Jesus. God's going to place people in your path for you to share the good news of the gospel with, for you to share how he reached into your heart and changed your life. Amen.
Amen.
Goes on to say after this, it says, it came to pass when he was, verse 12, in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. You know, one of the first things I did was I looked up that word full, and it said to be covered with or to be overcome. That's kind of like the picture, probably, of what we had of that person in the beginning. I mean, he was so full of leprosy, he was overcome with it. It was no longer just a little spot on his head that he had to present himself to the priest. This poor person right here, long ago, his verdict of unclean had been given. Long ago, he had been living a life of separation. Nobody really knows, we're not told how many years it was. But if you can imagine his life, walking around, probably covered up, and anytime anybody would get near him, unclean, unclean, I'm unclean. That's what he had to scream out, because he didn't want anybody to get too close and for your respiratory droplets to get on. Unclean, don't approach me, I'm unclean. He's a leper. And all of these years separated from the people of God. And all of these years living in isolation, living in separation, constantly having to cry out unclean. I was thinking to myself, surely, I don't know how long he's been having it, but surely there was a time that he hoped in his heart that God would show up for him like he showed up for Miriam, or that God would show up for him like he showed up for Naaman. I'm getting emotional thinking about it, because I'm thinking about the desperation in people's hearts whenever they find themselves overcome with various things in their life and they feel hopeless and they cry out to God and they say, God, won't you show up? But at the same time, all they keep on thinking is, unclean, unclean, when will God show up and move in the midst of my circumstances? And I would imagine that day after day, week after week, year, after a period of time, he became hopeless. He became hopeless and he began to think, you know what, there's just no hope for a leper like me. I'm going to have to live to the end separated. I'm going to have to live to the end outside the camp, away from the presence of God, as I watch this sinful condition called leprosy deteriorate my body and make me look different on the outside as it continues to kill me on the inside. And then one day he saw Jesus. The new covenant showed up. Hallelujah. The bread from heaven became flesh. And when he saw Jesus, the word of God says that he besought him. And that word in the original language, it describes desperation. It describes the fact that somebody's in lack. Lord, I beseech you. I besought him. Can't you see my condition? I'm overwhelmed and I'm full of leprosy. If you don't show up and if you don't do something right now in my life, Lord, I'm not going to ever be different. I'm going to constantly be outside of the camp. I'm going to be in isolation. I'm going to be in separation. You're the only hope that I have. I need you to intervene. I beseech you, Lord, won't you reach down and touch me? And if the Lord, if thou wilt, you can make me clean. He put forth his hand and he touched him and said, I will be thou clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him. Hallelujah. You know, I started thinking about the immediately of this circumstance. I was sitting here walking around and I was kind of thinking about it. I was reading in my Bible and I was thinking about immediately's. That all the time in Jesus' ministry there was immediately's. It just happened and left and right immediately. Not tomorrow, not next week, immediately. God did a work immediately in the midst of this man's life. He's one way at a moment, and in the midst of his desperation, he beseeches Jesus and he falls down upon his face and he said, if you will, you can make me clean. Jesus says, I will. And immediately he tonight, the next story, the man with the palsy. After they pulled away the tiles and they let him down, Jesus touched him, and immediately he was made whole. He got up and he started walking. I was thinking about the man at the pool of Bethesda. Remember that? The lame man. I think it was 38 years. He laid there and he was waiting. He was waiting for an angel to stir the water. Once again, the old covenant, outdated religion, could not change, could not help man, only to a certain extent. Jesus shows up and says, "Will you be made whole? Rise up," and immediately he was changed. The Word of God says, we preached it in Luke chapter 13 a while back, that there was a woman, and she was bent over with an infirmity. Remember that? She was bent over. She couldn't walk up straight. I mean, I just imagine how much people would laugh at her when she walked down the street. You know what? The next time I see that poor guy, I'm praying for him. You seen him in town? That's how he walks around. He works. I know he does. He's got a work truck. He gets in it. And I see him walking around, and you know, I sure don't want to, but I'm like, it's such a strange visual to see him walking around like that. And the next time I see him, I'm praying for him. Lord, help me see him. The woman walking around 18 years, bent over. And no lies, the Word of God says, because she straightened herself up. Jesus called her over there to him. He still calls people to him, amen. He reached down and he touched her. And the Word of God says that when he touched her, immediately she was straightened up and she began to glorify God. In this story right here, immediately this leper was changed, and Jesus said, "Don't go tell anybody. Instead, bring yourself to the priest, show them what happened, and let it be a testimony unto them."
Right.
But the Word of God says in the book of Mark, he began to publish it. He began to be a herald. He didn't listen to Jesus. I don't know what you do with that, but this is the thing. He starts being a public crier. "Jesus of Nazareth, heal me. You got to come see this man." That's what the Word of God says in the book of Luke. Even though Jesus told him, "Don't tell anybody," it says that his fame spread abroad and that all the sick became to him. And the same thing goes with the man at the pool of Bethesda. God healed him. I don't know that he said anything, but just carrying his mat around on the Sabbath caused the Pharisees to see it. They saw a change take place.
Amen.
38 years, this old boy is laying down at the pool of Bethesda, and now all of a sudden, he's got the audacity to walk around on the Sabbath, bearing a burden, carrying his mat.
Right.
Who changed you, man? I don't know his name. He showed up over there, and he told me that if I wanted to walk, to get up. And the truth of the matter is that the Pharisees saw the change in him. The Word of God says that that man who was paralyzed, immediately he began to glorify God. The word means to bring honor to. The word ultimately means to bring fame to. It's when you make somebody famous. Because with your mouth you praise him. And with your life and your mouth you worship him. Amen. And you begin to spread the word abroad. The Word of God says that when that woman that was bent over, he said, "Woman, you are loosed." And she immediately stood up, and immediately she began to glorify God. She made him famous. Amen. The point that I want you to know is this, is that just as immediate as those healings were, so was your salvation. You need to understand this, Christian. I've done some teaching with some preaching in the midst of all of this, but I need you to understand something. You will never be more righteous than the day that you gave your life to Jesus. Yes, we're all a work in progress. Yes, we all have things in our life that God is working on. Amen? But when you put your faith in Christ, the Word of God teaches, and I know you see it a lot of times, but let me do it again. The Word of God teaches that the old man born of Adam was born broken and dead, but that the new man born again in Jesus, hallelujah, has a new position, and now he's been clothed with the righteousness of Jesus. And because you're in Jesus, and the Father sees you in Jesus, and because he is the true righteous one, and you've been clothed with his righteousness, a new verdict has been spoken over your life. The verdict is not unclean. The verdict is not leprous. The verdict is justified. And that's what the Word of God says in Romans 5, the first portion. "Therefore, being justified by faith," you've been declared legally righteous, legally innocent by the Father of heaven, not because of your performance, but because of what? Faith. Justified by faith. Faith in what? Faith in the plan of God. God's plan from the beginning. The unleavened bread was Jesus. The Passover lamb was Jesus. And throughout all the Old Testament, the tabernacle tabernacle was Jesus. The mercy seat was Jesus. The blood of the Lamb was Jesus. The brazen altar was the cross. The brazen laver was the word that reflects back to Jesus. The menorah was the lampstand, which was the light that lit up the tabernacle. He's the light of the world. The bread that was replaced, he's the bread of life. He's the face bread. He's the one that allows communion between the Father and the people. Amen. He's the incense because he's the intercession. He's the Ark of the Covenant that you and I need to get into. All of the Old Testament is reflected to Jesus. And when we keep our faith in him, the Father says, justified. Yeah. Just as fast and immediate as those healings took place, it's just as fast and immediate as you were proclaimed justified in the eyes of God. Amen? Yeah. That's a good word. Not because I said it, because that's the word of God. Yeah. And if you and I will learn to believe that, we'll learn to appreciate that.
Yes.
And when we learn to appreciate that, we allow God to have his way in our life. Amen?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I wanted to just close with a couple of things. I missed that one, you know. We don't have to get into it too much, but you know, that was supposed to be around toil. That the old covenant, the law, was weak because of the flesh of man. Amen. But now we're not dependent on the flesh of man. We're not dependent upon the performance of man. Instead, we're dependent upon the performance of Jesus. So I wanted to leave you with 4 points to remember. Number one, you need to remember something. Sin is an internal problem, and it must be dealt with on a spiritual level. You can't rehab this problem away. You can try. Oh, I tried. I can't tell you how many rehabs I've been in. I'm here to tell you, you can't rehab this problem away, brother. You can't try to fix and form and conform and mold yourself, and nobody else, including your sponsor, can do that for you. No other man is going to mold you.
Amen.
No other man can conform you into the image of Jesus.
Amen.
You're either going to do it according to the world's ways, or you're going to do it according to his ways. His ways are an internal change.
Amen.
Oh, you're just beating up the program. No, man, look, I've been in the program. And I'm not beating nothing up. But what I will tell you is this. When I sat in there and tried to talk about Jesus, it was cool the first time. It was okay the second time. The third time, they were aggravated. I'm glad you found your Jesus, but if I want this table to be my higher power, you don't have no reason to judge me. I said, I'm not here to judge you, brother, but I'm going to tell you something right now. If you think that table is going to give you power, you're in for a world of hurting, bro. You might not drink a drop, but you just as soon be a dry drunk, because all that stuff on the inside of you, if you hadn't let Jesus in, you could not drink, but he still hadn't dealt with the bitterness.
Amen.
He still hadn't dealt with the envy. He still hadn't dealt with the maliciousness. He still hadn't dealt with the jealousy. He still hadn't dealt with the anger. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
They can't fix you on the outside.
Yeah.
Sin is an internal problem. It has to be dealt with on a spiritual level. The works of man's hands, like the law on Peter's net, they're empty of fruit. They cannot produce. You understand that? Man's hands cannot produce. You end up with an empty net. You end up with a lack of harvest. You and I need the bread from heaven to show up in the midst of our life. We need to invite him into the midst of our heart. And we need to beseech him like the leper in a place of desperation. We need to beseech him like the friends of the paralytic and start removing the towel and drop it right down in the midst. And I'll preach it to the preacher. We need to be in a place of desperation and cry out to the Lord, Lord, I need you to move and to do something in the midst of my life. Oh, hallelujah. Watch the fruit show up. Number three, once Jesus gets a hold of you, you're going to know it. I'm telling you right now, once Jesus gets a hold of you, you're going to know it. And when others see the change, Jesus will get the glory.
Yes.
See, the leper, hallelujah. They may not respond like they're supposed to right away. Come on. But when Jesus gets a hold of you, you're going to know it, and you're not going to be able to keep your mouth shut.
Amen.
You can tell that leper, don't go say anything. But the reality of it is you can't keep the mouth shut of somebody that's been a leper for all of these years, and now all of a sudden his skin is like that of a baby. And you think I'm not going to tell somebody? Oh, no, I got to tell somebody. And this woman has been over for 18 years. You think she's not going to glorify God? Oh, no. And not only that, whenever the change happens, like the Pharisees, that man coating his mat, they're going to notice. See, at first they may begin to call you out. Some of your children might call you out, some of your family members. Yeah. Oh, you were always that way. Who you think you are to talk to me that way, but I'm not that way anymore. Do you know what? Just let's all learn together. I got about, I don't even know how long I've been saved now. I've been saved a long time. 27, 28 years, something like that, maybe 30 years, I don't know. I've learned a little bit. And one of the things I've learned is this: soft answer turns away wrath. Mm-hmm. Maybe sometimes I don't need to be so prideful about the change that's taking place, and maybe I can tone it down and just be soft. Sometimes I have an attitude that I don't mind being hard behind the pulpit, but sometimes in person, maybe I just need to tone it down a little bit and be soft. Amen. And expect that not everybody's going to be where I am. And to say that a soft answer turns away wrath. Mm-hmm. Oh no, you misunderstand what I'm trying to tell you. I know I was a mess. You think I don't know I was a mess? This was me, this was me, this was me, this was me. But that ain't who I am no more. Jesus showed up and he changed me. All I'm trying to do is tell you that, and sometimes you know who it is? It's the religious folk. It's the people that have been in church all this time. And like, well, what do you think you got a hold of that I don't have? Well, the tendency typically, and sometimes you got to say it is that something ain't working right. Something ain't working right because the focus of your faith isn't right. You're not seeing the change take place that needs to be changed. And the fact of the matter is that sometimes we have to say things to people that's automatically going to offend them. But Lord, help us to season our speech with salt so that it'll come across the right way. Amen? Amen. Anyway, God's going to get the glory is the main point I wanted to tell you. Hallelujah. And number four, the healings we discussed, I got a typo, were immediate, and so is salvation. Yes, we're always a work in progress, but the truth is that true righteousness is an immediate thing. That you were born of Adam. It looks like I made my font too big. You were born of Adam in sin, but when you got saved, God put you in Christ, amen, and immediately you were pronounced righteous in the eyes of God. That's a good word from the Lord, amen. That's the new covenant. Jesus has come to do something on the inside that the old covenant could not do. So therefore, as a New Testament Christian, and we're going to preach about that tonight, as a New Testament Christian, we should not attempt to live according to the old order of things. Instead, we need to live according to the new order of things. The new order of things is faith in Jesus Christ and Him crucified, which releases grace in the life of the believer, which is a divine influence on the heart, and it begins to be reflected outwardly. Amen?
Amen.